The following is a special presentation of the Decibel Geek Podcast. Decibel Geek Podcast with Aaron Camaro and Chris Sinzak.
If you're looking for a podcast that rocks you to the top, well, you've come to the right place. Welcome to the Decibel Geek Podcast. My name is Aaron Camaro, joined as always by my fellow Tesla-loving friend, Chris Sinzak.
I'm excited.
Oh, super excited, man. I always love doing Albums Unleashed, and it always seems to be albums that we really, truly love, and today is no exception.
Yeah, this is going to be a fun one. I've been wanting to do this for a while. I've become pretty friendly with Troy Luccketta over the last couple of years, and been wanting to get him on the show, and this week we finally get that.
Man, this is special.
Yeah.
This is special today. You guys are going to get to find out some stuff you never knew before.
Yeah, great stories about the beginnings of Tesla, the recording process, and mechanical resonance. A lot of cool behind-the-scenes looks.
Heck yeah. You ready?
Yeah, let's do it.
Here we go. Albums Unleashed, Tesla Mechanical Resonance, right here on the Decibel Geek Podcast.
Thanks for coming on, first of all.
Yeah,
and,
it's awesome.
We do these series of shows called Albums Unleashed. It's probably our most popular theme that we do. We basically take an album that Aaron and I love every song on and get somebody that was involved with the record, talk about how it was made, stories behind the making of it, songwriting stuff, all that stuff. And this was a good one. I talked to you about which one you wanted to do, and this seemed like a natural choice because you can kind of talk about the beginnings of the band this way because it was the first one.
Absolutely.
So, this was released December 8th, 1986 on Geffen Records, produced by Steve Thompson, Michael Barbiero, and recorded at Bearsville Studios. But let's go back before this. So, I understand the band was calling it, still calling itself City Kid while you were recording this?
The band was called City Kid, yeah, while we were tracking the record. So, I'll preface, we're going to go a little bit further back, a couple years back when I joined the band.
Okay.
So the song Coming At You Live, they had written when they were in Guam. The band had went to Guam and played out there, played some club, and, you know, they had like a, I don't know if it was a residency, you know. Or,
yeah.
And when I had gotten this phone call from a guy named Dwayne Hitchings, he was over Eddie Money's house, and he said, hey, I want to come play you a demo of this band I'm producing. An Eric Martin band. I was just coming off that. That band had just broken up. We were getting ready to wrap things up. I said, sure, come on over. He played me the songs, two songs, a song called Restless Hearts and Rock City. Both of them recorded with a drum machine. But right away, when I heard Jeff's voice, I was like,
yeah,
I think I want to check this out, you know. I mean, it just kind of really caught my attention. So I went down, seen the band, and I remember them playing Coming At You Live that night, and I thought that was really cool. They were playing lots of covers. They had a few originals, nothing that I really remember. But that one particular track, which is obviously a staple for the band,
which
is cool because I always thought it was a great song. And so what happened was when I joined the band, we started just writing and writing and writing. And we were playing at clubs, a place called The Oasis in Sacramento. And what happened was we were there pretty much quite a bit, a few times out of the month, doing, you know, three nights in a row and playing covers, writing, putting some originals in. And I think it was probably after we had went to... We opened for Ron Keel doing a showcase for a gal named Teresa Ensenat.
Okay.
the country club in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. Right. And that was the night that she knew she was going to sign the band, and she brought us to a guy named Tom Zutad, who was at Elektra Records, and Tom was the guy who signed Motley Crue, Dokken, and Guns N' Roses.
Yeah, he's a big figure.
Bands like that. So he's seen us. They knew they wanted to sign us. Long story short, we ink a deal with Geffen Records when he made the move from Elektra to Geffen. And we had a manager at the time that didn't work out. I'm going to go real short on this story because I'm going to fast forward to Cliff Bernstein and Peter Mensch, who managed at Q Prime Management. They had Metallica, Dokken, Queensryche. Who else was on the on? They had quite a few bands. At any rate, they had a pretty good roster. Mm-hmm. Def Leppard. They had Def Leppard as well. So they flew out to see us, because Tom was going to sign us. He knew he was going to sign us. We hadn't made the record. So when they came out to see the band in the club, they liked the band. And they said, well, write some new songs and send us some new tracks. Well, that next week, and I'm telling you, in about a seven-day period, I think we probably wrote 80% of Mechanical Resonance.
Wow.
Yeah. A lot of good songs on there.
Serious chemistry going on.
Yeah. So we were writing machines. If my memory serves me well, that's my reality. I could be lying to you because I can't always trust that. But that's how I remember it.
Yeah.
And, you know, and basically we sent those tracks out and they signed us.
That's pretty cool.
That kind of got the ball rolling, you know?
Yeah.
Because you always hear the story, like the first album, like, oh, these are the songs this band's been playing for years.
Yeah, not the case.
Not the case here.
It's very different.
That's pretty wild.
Was Sacramento like a big rock scene at the time?
There was a good club scene going on, and there were some bands out there that were, you know, making some noise. And, you know, I was from the Bay Area, and I was in the San Francisco markets, and I was with Eric Martin Band coming off all that, and there was a great scene happening.
Oh, yeah.
You know, they had the Bay Area Music Awards, the BAMMY Awards, and all this cool stuff, and you had all the, you know, the best of the best of what was happening. I mean, you had Jefferson Starship, you had Carlos Santana, you had Journey, Eddie Money, Eric Martin Band, which was Night Ranger. You had just so much music.
Y&T. Metallica.
Yeah. You know, Metallica. I mean, it was just, it was off the charts, man. It was so cool. The scene was really happening. You know, so, I mean, obviously it's a different scene today, but...
Was there ever any thoughts of going down to L.A. and, like, stationing there?
Well, we did go down there, and we did some demos.
Yeah.
But the band never wanted to really do the L.A. thing. The band really wasn't an L.A. band.
No.
You know, we ended up going to Woodstock, Bearsville Studios, Upper State New York, and we started pre-production for 2 weeks. We went into this rehearsal barn with our producers to start fleshing out the songs that we were going to record. We had a two-track set up in there, and we would just go in there, and we would, you know, go through the songs, and we would just get a good, nice live feel of what it is we wanted to record.
Mm-hmm.
And this record was approached that way, with all of us playing in a room, you know, on 24 tracks. You know, 2-inch tape, and yeah, man, we're just full of piss and vinegar, man, and we're just ready to go. You know, I love Tesla today. I love the band. I love this. I go back and I'm listening now because we're digging deep for tracks and things and stuff. You know what? We've done okay, man. There's a lot of great music there.
Oh, tons of
them. There's a lot of great music and a lot of great songs. You know.
Yeah.
You know, so that's.
I think you're one of the bands that has stood the test of time from the 80s more than so many others.
Sure.
I mean, I'd put you guys and maybe Striper up there with, like, where I'm saying they're still doing their best material. Because they, you know, and Striper survived it too, because they went through, you know, they got mocked unmercifully, you know, for years.
Right.
But they're putting out some of their best material now.
Absolutely.
And they've, you know, it's like the long distance runner wins a race, you know. But, what I view with this album in particular is you guys are wearing your influences on your sleeve. Because, like, I can hear Aerosmith, Zeppelin, CCR.
It's all there,
In a lot of these songs.
Yeah.
Which is cool because it's,
Yeah, but there's nothing pretentious about a song like "We're No Good Together." When I just had, I was on the piano when that, I wrote that on the piano. It's not that I wrote any great big, I mean, it's four chords, you know. I was playing the piano and Frank was on the drums and Jeff just started singing. Boom, there it was.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how it came together. There was nothing pretentious about that. We weren't and never out trying to be pretentious and write. We're not that band.
Right.
So people, as far as that goes, that's not who we are.
Yeah.
We've always stayed true to who we are, writing what it is. We get a riff, it feels good, we play, we go. Jeff starts singing, you know, and it's built upon usually a riff.
Yeah.
Or a guitar. Sometimes they're, very rarely back then did we have complete songs.
Right.
It was a lot of band, you know, it was the influence of all of us coming together, bringing those songs together.
Right. Gotcha.
That's cool.
So let's go a little bit through the tracks and
just do it.
Yeah, so it's track one, Easy Come, Easy Go. Like,
you're gonna love this story.
Tell me the story behind this song.
I got a great story for you on this one. Now, the fact of the matter is, the song came together as is, as you hear it. And we had a producer that was involved with the band, and he decided that he felt the chorus needed to change. And it turned into a more easy come, easy go,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
really. And when Tom Zutat heard that, he was livid. What'd you do to the song, blah, blah, blah.
Heard
and
that song
unfortunately, they let him go.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
And we ended up with Steve Thompson and Michael Barbaro after that.
Remember who the producer was?
I do, but he's a dear friend of mine.
Oh, okay.
Lives here in Nashville, and it just happened the way it happened, you know. So,
right, gotcha. But
is it Michael Wagner?
No,
we love Michael Wagner.
Okay. No, it's not Michael.
Okay,
we've had him on the show several times.
So yeah,
great guy. Okay, so Easy Come, Easy Go opens the album. Well, before we get into more of the songs, so. The name Tesla, you went from City Kid to Tesla. What was the inspiration for using the name Tesla?
Well, it was real simple. We were in Bearsville, had pretty much, the record was in the middle of the recording. And I got a great story when we were looking for names. We didn't have a name at the time, and the Pretenders were in Studio B.
Oh.
With Claremountain, Bob Claremountain. And I remember, I had just got done smoking a joint. And this is, you know, first album. By the way, guys, I'm 25 years sober, just for the record.
Yeah, yeah.
but anyway, but so I did. I was high and kind of, and I'm paranoid high guy. That's who I was when I'd get, you know, high in pot. You know, it just used to make me kind of paranoid and weird. And I was sitting out there, and I was like, oh, my God, here comes Chrissy High. She's walking. She's walking right up to me. She starts up a conversation, and I'm like, I didn't even want. You know, you don't want to talk to somebody.
Yeah.
You know?
Can't look them in the eye.
And she's just going and talking about her new record, blah blah blah. She goes, "Hey, you want to come in and hear the record?" And I'm like, "Sure, you know." So I'm walking down the hallway. And here comes Brian Wheat. I go, "Come on, Brian, come with me, man. You know, Chris is gonna play us a new record, you know." So we go in the studio and she plays us like half the record. But while she was doing that, we told her the story a little bit about what was going on with us, and we were looking for a new name. And the next thing you know, she picks up this newspaper. She's so intelligent and so witty. She just starts rambling through the paper and she just starts throwing names at you. And because she's so witty, everything she says made sense.
Yeah.
And you could have taken 100 names from her right then and there.
Wow.
And you knew why you could, because it was like just the way she sold it to you.
Right. Yeah.
It was amazing. I mean, I was so blown away with her. She was so amazing. So what happened? We didn't really. We ended up leaving and, you know, working and doing our thing over the next few days. And what happened was Cliff Bernstein showed up, and we were talking about the record, and you know they were reviewing the record, and you know, and the name came up again, and he says, "Well, you know, I've been thinking, you know, how about Tesla?" Mm-hmm. And we're like, "Well, what the for Tesla?"
Yeah.
So he gave us the whole story of Nikola Tesla and who he was, and he felt for marketing purpose, just the name Tesla in of itself would be great. Mm-hmm. Now, mind you, Tom Zutat, who signed us, had turned Cliff Bernstein onto Nikola Tesla.
Really?
So that's where it came from, and he told us about this book called Man at a Time, by the author was Margaret Cheney, and you know, suggested we all read it. So we just kind of decided that, you know, Tesla, yeah, that sounds cool. It's electric. It's rock and roll. And, you know, and that's kind of how the name came to be.
There wasn't any of the guys that were like, no, we have to be City Kid. We don't
Nobody wanted City Kid.
Okay.
No, that was like, no.
Was it more of a placeholder?
No, that was the band I joined.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
City Kid. They were young kids playing rock and roll. And for the time, what they were doing, I mean, Frankie was 17 when we signed the record contract.
Wow.
When we made the first record. Good stuff.
Well, let's get into Coming At You Live. I love the guitar duel at the beginning of the song. Mm-hmm. I'm sure Tommy and Frank were big Van Halen fans at the time.
Sure.
Because they're doing some of those tricks back and forth.
Sure.
It kind of reminds me of like the intro to Mean Street. You know, it has that kind of a, I don't know what you call it, widdly stuff at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And then, but the drums are just so huge on these songs.
Wow, it's interesting. You know, I think they just got a rawness to them that I like.
It sounds like you're in a concert hall. It doesn't sound like it's out of a studio.
Yeah. Was finished, and where my perception was, it wasn't until later where I could really go, oh, this is cool. You know?
So what did you think of it at first when you heard your drum tracks? What would you like to, at that time, like different?
I thought everything was pretty cool. I thought the record sounded pretty good. I mean, today it sounds dated to me, but a lot of reverbs and things, but on Jeff, and a little more than it's that time stamp, you know.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's not like Psychotic Supper,
right?
You know, which is kind of timeless in my opinion.
Yeah.
Where that record, I love that record. But anyway, I'm very pleased with overall what it is. It's like, you know, it's our Van Halen one, right?
Yeah,
sure.
Pretty much.
Of course.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the record that put us on the map.
Yeah. Coming At You Live has been a staple for as the set opener for a long time.
Yeah. And it's not even in the set this year.
It's not? You're opening with something else.
I've got 25 songs in there that we've got a set list of changing in and out. I mean, we're going really, like, let's change things up. We've been playing, you know, last 3-4 years on these hit packages, you know, opening up in 40 minutes of hits. And
right.
It's like we're kind of burned out on that, you know.
And I kind of stretch out a little bit on this next run.
Yeah, we want
to. Cool, yeah.
That's awesome. It's going to be good. I think I'm really excited about the stuff we're going to do this year. Yeah. Some of the staples in the set. It's going to rock.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So then
I love that when bands do that. Sometimes you get sad because you, oh, this is the same exact show I seen 2 years
ago. No, not this year. Not for Tesla. We got a whole new... Awesome. It's going
to
be good.
Well, I know the diehards are going to love to hear
that. Yeah.
Awesome. So then Getting Better is track 3. Any particular stories on the making of that song?
Wow, man. I just remember Frank had the guitar part, and I remember when Jeff came up with that vocal in the intro, and it just had a great working class vibe to it. Mm-hmm. You know, pretty straightforward. It's in 3, you know, 1, 2, since 7-4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1. So that's with a quarter note, but it still feels like it's in 4, you know?
Yeah.
So it doesn't really skip a beat like if you were doing a 9-8 thing or something in all time. Yeah, it was cool. It had a cool riff, and great song, great video. Great. I'm good with that one.
Yeah. When I was reviewing it today, I love that. It's kind of an old school production technique where you've got Jeff's vocal in one track, and then you've got the music in the other track, like one in one ear and one in the other. And
is that right?
On the beginning.
I didn't even know if I noticed that.
Yeah, his vocal comes through on the left channel.
Okay.
And
well,
the music's on the right channel.
And if you go back to the day, right, yeah, once you hit, and everybody kicks in. Yeah. And you know, it was cool because, I mean, back in the day, you know, when they were recording 4 and 8 tracks, I mean, you'd have the drums, all the drums on the left.
Right.
Yeah. And the music, and it's funny, you mute one side and you got just the vocal and a guitar. Mm-hmm. You can't even hear the drum, you know.
Yeah.
Or you could just mute out the vocal and listen to the drums. That was cool. Yeah, we didn't go that far. And what's unfortunate, you know, not to go on another subject, but Jeff Emmerich from the Beatles just passed away. And Brian had just met him and did a class with him in Texas at where we had recorded a record. At any rate, we were going to go in with him.
Oh, wow.
It was,
we
were going to go in with Jeff over to Sun Studios in Memphis.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that was on the, we were going to do an EP.
Wow.
And maybe we would have got into some of that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Where I'm going. Who knows? Maybe we would have ended up there, but.
Well, anyway. That technique's not really used too much anymore.
Yeah.
Like
no, you don't.
Stereo.
Not, I haven't really heard.
And I always thought Jeff's vocals at the beginning kind of remind me of Fogerty doing the song Lodi.
Okay, I was born in Lodi, one of my favorite tracks. Absolutely. Lodi, California, that's where I was born.
I love this. And then when the whole thing kicks in, it kind of has an Aerosmith vibe to it to me. I love that song. Like, that might be my favorite song on the first side. You know, we still look at albums as sides. Most people don't anymore.
Right.
Yeah.
Everybody always used to talk about the B side of Abbey Road, you know.
Yeah.
Right.
So then you go to track 4, which is the number 2 late, the number 4 love. Too late for love.
It's more cool 80s stylizing.
Yeah.
You know, man, I just remember that being a real busy week.
Yeah.
I suppose.
And I think I'm probably well disillusioned on my 80% thing, you know, the first week. But I know that it was a week later that we had sent off those tracks, and, you know, management was excited about what we were doing because we were writing so many songs. We would just pump stuff out.
Mm-hmm.
Too Late for Love. I was always coming up with things and ideas, and I was always making a strong contribution to the tracks.
It's like a marching beat at the...
Yeah, and, you know, I was, you know, so we would get into a vibe and set it up, and because we always had those twin guitar players that wanted to experiment and do things and create funky noises with the guitars and whammies and... And, yeah. A riff, we would just start getting a vibe,
yeah,
and fall into things, and that's pretty much how that came together, as most of them did.
Yeah, yeah. On that one, one thing I know, and you integrated a lot through the album that a lot of 80s bands didn't do, that a lot of 70s bands did, was they would back up the electric guitars with acoustic tracks,
yeah,
to kind of like beef up
sure.
the sound.
Mm-hmm.
I love that you guys did that on the album.
Mm-hmm. Frank was pretty good about that. He liked grabbing his acoustic and 6-string or 12-string.
Mm-hmm.
Putting some backing track behind it, like in the chorus.
That really kind of set you guys apart.
Mm-hmm. Really, it's really prominent in the chorus.
Yeah, I always like that. And then track 5, Rock Me to the Top.
Sounds like a Tommy Skeel riff to me.
Yeah.
God bless Tommy, man. He brought that side of the band, you know.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I remember him just, I could see him. I got this riff. Blah, 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 you know.
Yeah.
All right, let's go, man. And there you go. Back to the top.
Are in there and you're cranking out all these songs. Was there anything recorded that didn't make it onto the album?
Tons of stuff. We got all, tons of demos.
Yeah. You save all that stuff?
We do have it all put away. We wanted to put out a rock box thing.
Yeah.
You know,
a Tesla vault.
Yeah, we have. I mean, tons of demos.
Awesome.
Tons of demos.
I always love to hear that from my favorite bands because it's like you always get, like I said on the show this last week, you know, we're talking about the new album. The more Tesla songs in my life, the better I feel my life is. You know,
awesome.
In some bands, you feel like, okay, well, they're done now, so there's a cap on that. And then when you find out your favorite bands have been saving these demos and different versions and songs and stuff like that over the years, it's like, oh man, there's even more classic Tesla songs out there that I've never even heard.
there's a lot of stuff out there that we had recorded that, yeah, will never probably see the light of day unless it comes out in something like that.
I was going to say, don't say never, because you want to hear all that stuff.
Yeah, and, you know, we started to work on all of that, and I think it had to do with the fact that Universal, who has our new record, and now they got our catalog, so we might be able to put all that together now, because we were going to do it, but at the time, I think there were some conflictions.
Yeah. I mean, we know a guy named Sean Franklin who does that with Anthrax, and Charlie Benante sends him all these old tapes and stuff, and he sits down and goes through it, and then opens up them lines of communications, and then when they come out with a remastered version of their album, like a classic one, it's got all kinds of extra things on there, and it's exciting, you know, because if you love that band and you get that, you know, it's like, okay, this is my, you know, Mechanical Resonance, I love it, but wait, there's another 12 tracks on there of stuff that was recorded around this time. It's exciting stuff.
And I think, you know, the longer you hang on to that stuff, the better it is. If we would have put it out shortly after and you just kind of let that stuff out, it doesn't mean as much. But today, for our fans, they would dig that. I think you're right. I think that's super cool.
So then we'll get to track 7, Modern Day Cowboy, which this is, I mean, this song doesn't need much of an introduction because it's pretty much one of your biggest staples.
Yeah, this is a song that broke you guys, right?
Absolutely. It's our first single.
Decibel Geek Army?
You slimy scumbag, get on your face and give me 25.
Join us on our fan page at facebook.com/decibelgeek.
We love you long time.
You got the Decibel Geek VIPs. You don't know about this? You gotta know about it by now. Head on over to patreon.com, look up Decibel Geek and become a part of it, because we're cranking out the Torpedo Dudes now. Yeah, we've got episode 2 up, and it's a Music from the Elder discussion. That's out now. Plus the one we did the week before with the Peter Criss discussion.
Yeah.
And there's, you know, it's a full another podcast, about an hour long. Or go over to patreon.com, sign up to become a Decibel Geek VIP, and all that, plus a whole lot more. We're talking hundreds of hours of extra audio content available for you right now. Go do it.
All for the price of a cup of coffee.
It's the perfect Christmas present.
It is.
Or Kwanzaa.
Give it to
or
yourself.
Hanukkah or Boxing Day or whatever.
Yeah, whatever.
This is not a test. This is Poison in concert. February 14th at Meadowlands Arena. Look what the cat dragged in. A super octane rock and roll of Poison. Poison and special guest Tesla. Tickets at the Meadowlands Arena, Ticketmaster, or call Ticketmaster Charge. Von Dilsner presents Rock and Roll for Valentine's with Poison.
Shock, the new album from Tesla.
Feel the shock and touch the lightning.
12 studio tracks produced by Phil Collin of Def Leppard. Featuring Taste Like, California Summer Song, Shock, and many more. Catch the band on tour throughout 2019. Tesla. Shock. Available March 8th. Pre-order now.
What are your thoughts on making videos back in those days?
A lot of fun.
Yeah.
Great. Exciting. You know, still fresh and new. You know, big budgets.
Yeah.
You know, you can do things pretty for real, not like today with what's happening with a lot of the bands, including us, you know. I mean, you don't have those budgets anymore.
Right.
You know, to do the videos. But people are still making them, but it's, you know, it's a different time.
Yeah.
Well, and the technology's changed too, where you don't really need all that stuff to make a video like that, you know, where you have to have a crew and all this. Now you can do that stuff on your phone.
No, not necessarily. Not the stuff we were doing, you can't do on the phone. I mean, they were setting stuff up. They would bring in, I mean, I watched them when we put Heaven's Trail together, and I remember that video. I remember being out in the middle of nowhere, and they had this stage set up. And it was a killer stage. And it looked like, man, it had ramps. It was just out in the middle of this field. And it was just phenomenal.
Yeah.
And in the middle of the shoot, I can't remember the director's name, decided, scrap the whole thing. A couple semis showed up. They put up a whole new stage, and they turned it in to Mad Max.
Yeah.
You know, and fire and all this stuff. And I'm like, Heaven's Trail, like, wow, that was freaking cool.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you know, those budgets are like $350,000, $400,000, $500,000 for to make those videos. And they went out.
Yeah.
You can do that on an iPhone.
No, no, you know,
that's
right.
It's, I mean, it's a little different time, you know, but there are, you know, there are things that can be done, and there are some good things, you know, creatively, and I get that, but I mean, there was really a lot going into that stuff back in the day, and a lot of money being spent.
Well, MTV could make or break you at the time.
Yeah, right. Yeah, and you know what? You had to be competitive, right?
Yeah.
Sure.
So,
yeah, a lot of competition.
Always trying to.
So, changes. Who's playing the piano on that?
Frank.
Frank is? Okay.
Yep. Now, you know, the thing about that is, if I remember correctly, it might have been Tom?
Oh, really?
That was Tommy who wrote that, I believe.
The guitar part kind of reminds me of Give Me Shelter a little bit.
I think so. I think, and Frank, you know, but there was, you know, I think I'd have to go back and look at the writing credits on that, but I think, I probably have to look on the sleeve. Does it have on there? Changes. Yes, Keo, Han, and Wheat. All of us.
Everybody.
Yeah, we're all on that one because, yeah, that's right. We all had a part in that one. And I remember that not being in that week that we probably wrote. Or maybe it was. But I do remember that song coming together, having that riff, and spending a day. And pretty much it was done.
Yeah.
You know, it was one of those times that just really came together.
Just making changes in my life, rearranging. Can't seem to stop the hands of time. I remember I was so young, I was much too young to see. Now I'm older, growing older, and I see things differently.
Best one usually come together fast.
You know, I mean, sometimes it happens, you know. Not always, but
right.
You know, sometimes you got to slave over a few things, work out some play. But we were pretty good about that.
Yeah.
Writing a song and pretty much having it flushed out in a day.
Yeah.
You know.
Pretty introspective lyrics on it, too.
Yeah. Yes, yeah. Absolutely. Which, it's in this year's show.
Huh? Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Right on.
That's a great song.
Mm-hmm.
What are these symbols? Do you know what they mean?
I think, no, they're just, I don't know what they mean.
What's that one?
I think they're just, you know, for me, they just look like, you know, computer parts.
Yeah.
You know, and speakers and just different, you know,
electronic stuff.
Insignia electronic stuff, you know, no machines and just, mechanical resonance.
That's cool. So then Little Susie's the next song on here. I got to get the story. I mean, who brings the PhD song to you guys and what's your
I was not in the band.
Oh, okay.
And Ronnie Montrose brought Little Susie to Tesla and produced the first demo of it before I was in the band.
Wow.
It was Ronnie Montrose's idea.
Yeah, forever. I didn't even know that was a cover until like a week ago. And then I saw the video and I was like, this is a weird song. Little Susie's on the up. Casting couch appointments made. Movies gonna hang around. Chopping sharp, Susie's okay.
I don't remember the original version. I don't even know if I had heard it. I never probably even heard it at the time. I never heard the original, so we just...
Oh, God.
And then Max Norman came in because he was going to be one of the producers on the first album as potential. We got together with him, and I remember he extended the B section pre-chorus, and that was one part that we kept. But outside of that, I mean, it was Ronnie Montrose who brought it. They probably have the original demo that Ronnie did, and that'll come out. With what you were talking about. You know, if we ever get those extra tracks out, those dead tracks. But
that'd be cool to hear.
Yeah.
Don't bring her down. She's a lot like you. She'll be richer by far if her dreams come true. Little Susie's on the air.
I think most people think it's an original of your guys's.
Cause like signs, you know, people thinking, you know.
Yeah.
It's got such a signature Tesla sound to it. You know, it's hard to listen to the other version. Like, oh, man, everything's missing.
You know, we made those songs ours. Definitely. Just like Signs, you know.
For sure.
Yeah, I was in high school when Signs blew up, and you couldn't get away from that song on the radio.
No, you couldn't. I remember that. That was a good time.
Huge.
And that's so nice when you get that kind of exposure.
Sure.
Yeah. You know, I pray to God we get some love on this new album, you know. I hope that works out.
Yeah, I think you will.
It's a good record.
Yeah.
And their songs, it's Our Hysteria. And with Phil Collin at the helm... Yes, there's some leopardish overtones in the record. We can't help it because he's singing on it too, playing on it, co-wrote everything. Mm-hmm. That's just a fact.
Right.
And it's okay. We let him. We said, hey, dude, make the record you want to make. We're here. You love the band. You want to produce the record? Awesome.
Yeah.
What do you want? What do you need from us? Let's do it. Wow. Let's go. Let's have some fun. And we did.
Awesome.
And he did it. I'll play it for you in a bit.
Yeah, I'm excited to hear it.
Mm-hmm.
So what can you tell me about the song Love Me?
Love Me?
Yeah.
That's not on the first album.
Yeah. It's right after Little Susie.
Really?
Yeah.
So sad. I think it is.
Man.
Yeah, it is.
No way.
Track 10.
God, I thought it was... Like I said, I'm glad it was on the first album. I'll tell you what about Love Me. It was one of those songs... I like the riff, you know, and I like the song. After we got done recording it, nobody wanted to play it. Jeff just couldn't sing it. Love me. You know, he's like, I'm not going to go out there and sing that song. Sometimes they're just made for the record.
Yeah.
And they're not made to be played live.
Right.
And I think that's one of those songs that just leave it on, you know, people enjoy it great. I mean, it's, you know, it's Love Me.
It's what they call the filler
track. Nothing deep in it, right?
Yeah.
Right.
But it's filler.
I thought it had a killer groove.
You never know. In that day, that could have been a huge hit.
Right.
You know,
right.
Never like know. That.
Well, you
just
know,
like all the bands.
It had that formula and the elements to be that kind of a song.
Right, yeah, that's what I'm saying.
But
Ask Extreme, how's that go? The one song that's unlike all the rest becomes your hit signature song.
Yeah, it's just, I'm the one who wants to.
Or Beth, you know, Beth by Kiss, you know.
They didn't want that on the record. They didn't want Love Song on the record. Nobody wanted Love Song on the record. Our management, our producers, and the label.
Really?
That's pretty wild the way that works sometimes.
You would think that would be the one they would go for.
They didn't get it. They thought it was three good parts of the song and three great parts that were parts, and it just wasn't a song.
Right.
Because it didn't have the traditional chorus.
That's why you're the musicians in there.
Right. Well, we fought for it. We got it. It works. So it's all good. Sold 2 million records. Top 10 hit.
That song was all over the place, too.
Yeah.
I mean, especially on MTV. I remember it got played all the time on MTV.
Yeah, that was a big one for us.
So let's get back to the last couple tracks. Cover Queen. This one's kind of different from the rest of the album to me. I think this one almost has more of the 80s sound to
Frank
it.
Frank was looking. He had that riff. I remember him coming in going, bounce, gah, gah, you know, just playing that riff. And we're like, nice. And what's really cool, if you check out how I come in on the drums, I'm playing a real different beat because I'm playing the ride of the bell and the hi-hat. And I was listening to, it's really a ripoff from Steve Gadd, one of my all-time favorite drummers. And I remember I was watching this video, and it wasn't nothing pretentious on it, just kind of happened. Sometimes your influences, you know,
they just kind of happen
and they come out, and you're working on this and you're doing that. And I didn't realize it was like a complete ripoff from what he played. I seen it on his video, and I'm like, oh my God, that's Cover Queen. But it's so freaking cool, man, and the way he played it. And that's what I put on the record, and it came out really, really nice. It's kind of a unique drum part. I like that song. I mean, it was a fun song to play. I remember being in the studio and Frank doing all that talk box stuff. And I remember, you know, Frank, I think one time he just got up there during the first record, and there was a lot of pot smoking and stuff going on. Everybody smoked pot back then, and you know, whether they were drinking or not, and we'd work till 2 in the morning. It didn't matter. That's how records were being made back in the day. It wasn't, you know, no 9 to 5 gig. It wasn't about that at all. It was all about just capturing the moment, and, you know, and I think he was up there in his underwear or something, standing on the console, you know, just rocking out and jamming, you know. And he was just, you know, I mean, he's 17, 18 years old.
Yeah, he was just having a good time.
You know, and just, he was awesome. A kid, decided to take his pants off and be in his underwear and jump on the console, you know. I don't know if there's any footage or photos. There was so much amazing classic stuff when I think back and I look back in the day, you know.
Did anybody have a...
I have some of that stuff.
Did anybody have a camcorder and film some of those
videos? We have... If we could just dig all that stuff out, we could just really do an amazing...
His fans would eat that up.
It really would. It would take some time for us to dig all that footage up. And I sure hope it does see the light of day sometime.
Cool.
Because that's really... Looking back now, 30 years later, it's cool.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, and then
so
like,
it is.
And you're like, stuff like, oh, I completely forgot we did that.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
That's cool.
Embarrass ourselves.
So then the album closes with Before My Eyes, and this is something that really doesn't happen much on albums anymore, but is the big epic song at the end of a record that has a long build-up to it, which, because back then you would consume an album all at one time, which, you know, people don't see the point in that anymore, but... I love the way the album ends with this because the song has so much atmosphere and it you know, takes up space, and it's a great way to end.
There's a song I wish we were playing live. We've played it in the past, and that's a fun one.
Yeah.
And I like the space in it, and I like the vibe and the guitars.
Great song.
And it is, you know, it sounds like, you know, like the band's on acid trip or something, you know. And that's what it was supposed to be.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, back in the day, you know, I mean, you know, I'm sober today, and it's interesting now to be having this conversation, but, you know, back then, you know, it was cool to smoke a joint and put on a pair of headphones.
Yeah.
Sure.
You know, kind of get lost in the music.
Yeah.
Put on Dark Side of the Moon.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, I've done
that. You know, but that was about the best we could do with that, what we had going on at that time, and that's our kind of a, you know... Smoke a joint, put some headphones on, and trip out. Right?
Right. So this many years later, it seems like you have a really good appreciation for its place.
I do now, definitely.
Yeah.
And it's funny, I just when Frank starts shipping these songs over, getting into the set, with what's going on right now, and digging up some old stuff, and I started listening to some of these songs, and I put them all into my iTunes, and just, I don't know, 25 songs, I think. I'm listening to all these songs go by, and I'm like, wow, that's really great, you know. Wow, that was really cool. I don't remember, you know.
Yeah.
That kind of stuff. And just listening, having a new appreciation. It's like a new set of ears, you know.
Right.
There might be an appreciation for what I've brought over the years, And if you talk to Tommy Scio, he will tell you, in his opinion, and I know this because he always let me know that, yeah, you're a frickin' nerd and you're this and you're that, but you're absolutely the greatest rock and roll drummer on the planet.
Right on.
Well, that's good enough, right?
Yeah.
That's how he thought of me. And not that it's true, but that was his perception. Right. And if that's his perception and he believed that, then that's cool. And I really love what he brought and what Frank brought. And now we got Dave all these years later, and it's got a different energy and a new thing. And Dave's so great. I mean, we couldn't have a better guy in the band. And, you know, we've really come a long way.
It seems like you guys are in a good place chemistry-wise.
We are. Yeah. We all get along, and we care about what we're doing. And, you know, it hasn't been any drugs or not even a beer backstage since 2004.
Oh, good.
No alcohol, nothing. You can't find an ounce of nothing on our Tesla tour. That's just how we roll.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, just we figured it out, and we decided we wanted to stay together, do the best we can, and figure out how to do it, you know, and be present.
Yeah.
I'm curious to what's going to happen with this new record, because there are some different sounds and production, and it'll be interesting to see what we choose to do and how to pull that off. And this was a record where we let a producer come in and really produce the band and bring that Mutt Lange to the band, and he's a junior Mutt Lange.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's all he knows. That's what he does, and there was nobody to do it better.
And I guess it's going to be available at all digital outlets and what record
everywhere.
Stores are left.
It's all there. I've already seen all the media push and everything they've got on it. It's every Target exclusive and all that.
Awesome. Well, thanks for doing the show, man.
Thank you for having me.
All right.
Thanks, Aaron. Thank you, Chris. Appreciate you.